We wanted to bring and have them showcase what they're doing, whether in Chicago or national. So with us, we're gonna have Taher Herzallah. Taher Herzallah is our own AMP, Assistant Director of Outreach and Community Organizing of the AMP National. Then we have Ahmed Abu Zneid. Ahmed belongs to another wonderful organization. He is the Executive Director of the U.S. Campaign for Palestinian Rights, USCPR. Then this, Ahmed and Taher are working national, and they do a lot of network, a lot of activism, a lot of civic engagement work, and they're in Washington in the Congress, in the hallways, always talking to legislators and doing a lot of things. Then we have my friends here from Chicago. These ladies, we've been working so hard together. We have Leslie Williams. Leslie Williams is a member. Leslie Williams is a member of the coordinating committee of Jewish Voice for Peace. She also started a co-founder of a synagogue that is pro-social justice in Chicago here.
Anti-Zionist
for social justice. So, she's been an ally. I text her every time a problem happens, and she's been amazing working with us in Chicago here. And then we have Jennifer Bain. Jennifer Bain has also, these ladies, all they do is advocate for Palestine. You know, we always said that we are talking to each other. We're not talking to each other anymore, because they take our cause to the churches and to the synagogues, and they are advocating for Palestine in order to change the narrative about Palestine. So Jennifer works for American Friends Service Committee, AFSC, in Chicago here. She works with a no way to treat a child, and she works for Gaza. There is another organization that she's doing for Gaza. So the third person here is Ashia Khan. And Ashia Khan is the interim CEO of the Muslim Legal Fund of America, MLFA. I'm sure you all heard about it. So when Gaza, you know, during the pandemic, and when I was struggling talking about Palestine, honestly, I was struggling, because how do you go to a legislator who we're all afraid for our lives, and you go to the legislator and tell me, you know, the occupation was hard for me. It was like, and then my friend at the Interfaith Coalition, they're like, me, Dad, this is the time for us to step up and talk, because with the vaccination apartheid, and Sheikh Jarrah and the bombarding of Gaza and all that, it was overwhelming, and they really have been a lot of support for us here in Chicago, and it's really, really appreciated. Thank you so much. The Muslim Coalition, Ashia belongs to the Muslim Coalition, Illinois Muslim Civic Coalition, and she's a board member also, and they came and they're like, how can we help? So they have a lot of expertise, and they just came and helped us with the rallies, with reaching out to the mayor. The network in Chicago here has been phenomenal. And everyone knows how we got 25,000 people in Chicago when we were, at the time of the Gaza attack. So we have been blessed to have a lot of allies, a lot of wonderful help and support. So we're going to start with Taher Herzallah to tell us about his work in Washington, D.C.
Thank you to you all for being here tonight, and a special thank you to Ambassador Nida Sahouli, our Chicago chapter chairwoman, who started this discussion talking about the Giants that work in Chicago, and you cannot talk about Giants in Chicago without mentioning the name Nida Sahouli. So a special round of applause for her and all the work that she's been doing over more than a decade with AMP here in the Chicagoland area. The work for Palestine in America is truly diverse and widespread. I know that we constantly talk about the shifting dynamics of US policy and what's taking place at the federal level, but it's really important to notice what is taking place locally in cities across the US. There are groups of people, organizations, communities, and coalitions in states across the country actively working on campaigns and initiatives that are actually at the root of why the shifts in dynamics are taking place in Washington, D.C. For example, just last year, in April of 2020, in the spring, in a city in North Carolina called Durham. Anybody here from North Carolina? Okay. Anybody here from the South? You're from the South? Oh, Florida. In Durham, North Carolina, something extraordinary happened. Led by a large coalition of multi-faith, multi-race organizations and groups, lobbied the city of Durham in a campaign called Demilitarize Durham to Palestine, lobbied and successfully got the city of Durham, North Carolina, to prohibit the training of their police force with the state of Israel. This was an extraordinary campaign, a one-of-a-kind campaign, a part of a broader campaign that one of our partner organizations, Jewish Voice for Peace, has been working on, called the Deadly Exchange Campaign, working to separate U.S. police forces from the training that they've been getting in Israel, led by none other than the ADL, the Anti-Defamation League. Another example, in a cross-movement invest-divestment win, the city of Boston in 2019 committed to moving $150 million in city funds into socially responsible investment. This was in Boston. In 2018, a mayor pulls the police chief from a trip to Israel. The mayor of Northampton, Massachusetts, pulled their police chief while they're on their way to the trip to Israel, pulled them from that and prohibited them from participating in that trip. In 2017, the city of Sacramento dropped G4S, a security company that is actively involved in the prison industrial complex in the United States and in Palestine. In 2016, the Denver Water Board dropped G4S as well, following a very sustained and heavy BDS campaign in Denver, Colorado. In 2016, the city of Portland's Socially Responsible Investment Committee recommended that the city boycott Caterpillar. Caterpillar, the company that manufactures bulldozers that are used to destroy Palestinian homes across historic Palestine. In 2015, the Oregon Department of Justice mandated that SodaStream, another company, an Israeli company, operating on an illegal settlement at the time, change misleading product labels. This was in Portland, Oregon. In 2014, the city of Baltimore rejected a Veolia contract following a massive coalition campaign that took place there. Veolia is a French conglomerate that was building and operating a light rail train system in occupied Jerusalem. And we also, in the city of Los Angeles, where I'm from, also led a campaign in 2014 against Veolia, where we lobbied the LA City Council to drop Veolia from managing the bus line in the city. And the campaign was so heavy and sustained that Veolia had to send representatives from the corporate office to counter our lobbying efforts. That's how serious they took this. And Veolia ended up losing billions of dollars in contracts due to sustained boycott efforts in the US and across the globe. In 2013, another Dump Veolia campaign, a historic Dump Veolia campaign, was successful in the city of St. Louis, Missouri. I'm mentioning cities here across the US where people are actively engaged in campaigns, but I'm not done yet. On the West Coast, in Los Angeles, Long Beach, and in the San Francisco Bay Area, a broad coalition of organizations from across the spectrum led a massive and sustained effort to block the boat, to block the Israeli shipping company Zim shipping line that is heavily involved in Israel's military industrial complex, and were successful in preventing the docking and unloading of those ships, to the point where Zim shipping company had to divert their ships to other ports, in some cases having to wait for weeks to get their supplies unloaded, offloaded off their ships, to the point where some companies that used the Zim shipping line broke their contracts with the company because they were losing money keeping their products on Zim shipping line. That's how successful this campaign was. In New Jersey as well, a similar campaign took place this past summer, along with the campaigns that were taking place on the West Coast. In Minnesota, anybody here from Minnesota? Yes. A very strong and sustained campaign against a company you all might have heard of. Anybody heard of Pillsbury? Anybody know what Pillsbury is known for? What is Pillsbury known for? The Doughboy. You know when they tickle his stomach and he laughs? Okay, that one. The Doughboy. Pillsbury, turns out, operates a factory on an illegal Israeli settlement. And the parent company, General Mills, is based in Minnesota. So a broad-based coalition there mobilized and organized and launched a campaign against General Mills and Pillsbury. The campaign was so heavy and continued. This is an ongoing campaign, by the way. This is something that's going on right now. But the campaign got so much traction that one of the members of the Pillsbury family, Charles Pillsbury, came out openly against the Pillsbury company and called for its boycott. These things are happening in our communities across the country. In Virginia, where I live today, local organizers are leading a campaign against Energix, a company founded and grown in the occupied Golden Heights. It's an energy company that works with solar power. They're working on getting contracts with counties across the state of Virginia. The Virginia Coalition for Human Rights, a coalition of grassroots organizations and individuals and community members from across the spectrum, work and continue to work to deny Energix the contracts with the state and with counties across the state. These are sustained, strategic, and important boycott initiatives. And across the US in more than 6 cities this year, AMP led a national boycott of Israeli dates, which has led to the sharpest decrease in imports of Israeli dates to the US over the last 5 years. Ibrahim, you got the graphic for me? It's not, can you give me that most of too? AMP's boycott initiative that started in 2012 to break your fast with justice, to boycott Israeli dates, has gotten so much traction where we have, you can see that we have the logos of the companies that are known Israeli companies selling their dates in the US. There's another company in Jordan called Jordan River Dates contacted us saying, please can you clarify that our dates are not the ones to be boycotted because it's impacting our company as well. That's how strong this boycott initiative has been. And this year we did something different. This year we expanded our date boycott campaign by making material in different languages. Here you see the poster in two languages. We actually have it in Spanish and in Urdu as well, to reach as many communities as possible to increase the impact and effectiveness of this campaign. Alhamdulillah, we've seen, based on the data that we're seeing from the U.S. Department of Agriculture, that the import of Israeli dates has been decreasing over the past 5 years. And I'm just scratching the surface here. There are so many more campaigns that I just simply cannot mention in one talk in 5 minutes or 3 minutes that I have remaining. Victories are taking place and campaigns are being launched in everything from the labor movements to college campuses, from corporate accountability campaigns to academic boycotts, from faith-based actions to pensions and other investment fund campaigns, sports initiatives and cultural boycotts. Ahmed could talk a little bit about, I think, the impact of celebrities joining boycott initiatives and campaigns against the state of Israel. This should tell you, this message should tell you, that your work, your initiative at a local level is as critical to changing the dynamics in America as anything that takes place in Washington, D.C. Anybody can launch a campaign. Anybody could look at their city's investments and find if they are investing in or contracting with companies profiting from the occupation. And you better believe that when a campaign like this takes place in your local town or major city, that politicians in that area are paying attention. And when they see that there is a critical mass building on an issue, they will start to think twice or three times before they say anything about Palestine. And that is exactly what we are aiming to do. Palestine, as Edward Said once said, in America, is a local policy issue. And this cannot be truer today. That is why we are encouraging all of you to participate in local campaigns if you live in cities that already have some, or initiate local campaigns. Because the work for Palestine is not limited to us in Washington, D.C., meeting with legislators and talking to members of Congress. Members of Congress look at what is happening in their district. Members of Congress look at what's happening in their local community. And if there is a sustained campaign against a corporation, or against a city council, or against a particular elected official, or on campuses, they are paying attention to those campaigns because they know that this issue is salient within their constituent base, within their own community. And that is what gives us power in Washington, D.C. That is what allows us to go into the halls of Congress with a sense of representation and power, that we can say, this is what our community stands for, this is what we're about, this is what we need you to do. So join us. I have big boycott posters outside on the AMP booth. We have plenty for you to take home and post in your local mosque, in your local community center, wherever you may be, in your local stores. Participate in a boycott initiative. These things matter. And what Imam Omar today said in his Friday sermon was more relevant than ever, that all of us have a unique responsibility considering our position as American taxpaying citizens, that we can take initiative, and that is what is happening on a national level. JazakAllah khair, and I'll pass it back to the ambassador to introduce the rest of the time.